How's everyone feeling? Good question, right? How are we feeling? We ask each other, how are you today? How's it going? How are you today? Well, it's okay. I'm fine. Feel pretty good. You know, do we ever ask God, how are you feeling? How do you feel, God? I did this morning. I said, God, I'd like to know how you feel. Instead of how do I feel? How do you feel? How does God feel? What's the feeling of God? Is God happy, angry, anxious, peaceful, concerned? You know, how does God really feel? Right? How does God feel is the question. How does God feel? Now, I feel tired today. Does God feel tired? I don't know. I feel tired because the last video, the Universal Guilt Trip and how to get free, broke so much new ground, intense ground, going further towards realization, that it really taxed my nerves severely. And I experienced severe fatigue. It was just awful. But that's been customary for me, because trying to speak the truth in this attention trap we call the world is exceedingly nerve-wracking. Now, so I say, I feel pretty lousy, but God, how do you feel? I want to know how God feels. Simple question, right? How does God feel? Do we ever ask that question? How does God feel? And I said, don't tell me. I want to experience it. I want to know, literally, experientially know, how does God feel? How does God feel? Perfectly legitimate question, isn't it? Do we know? We get up in our days going back, do we know how God feels? So, just that simple question, I said, well, I never even thought about that, asking how God feels. We go about our whole lives, we never take a moment to say, God, how do you feel? I always remember in these videos, keep a sense of humor and laughter, chuckles. Not due to jokes, but just due to the subject matter itself is humorous. Like, we've never asked God how God feels. That's funny. Very funny, isn't it? How could we not do that? You know, it's just, instead of getting angry at ourselves, laugh at it. Laugh like, oh, that's so silly that we never ask God how God feels. We don't even know how God feels. That's hilarious. Incredible omission, right? How could we possibly not know how God feels? We're an extension of God, and yet we don't know how God feels. And we're afraid to ask. It's the weird thing too, right? Could you imagine if we're afraid to ask our Creator how our Creator feels? Isn't that bizarre? I mean the Creator of Spirit, of course. Not bodies, but the Creator Spirit. So the Spirit's afraid to ask its Creator and that which it is one with. How does it feel? How does the Creator feel? How does the Prime Creator feel? So I ask God, I want to experience. Let me know. Let me experience how you feel. Hasn't happened yet, but I put the request out. So usually there's a little bit of a lag because of our continuity fear. Because if stuff starts happening simultaneously, instantly, that'll freak us out. See, this is the lag. There's a lag. Which is why we think, well, prayer doesn't get answered immediately, or things don't happen like we want them to. We're frightened. Because then I say, I don't know how to function. Everything happens instantly. Whatever I want is instantly there, kind of such a situation. So we sort of have this lag. That's why you can dream about what's going to take place in the future. And then it takes place. I'm starting to have that more and more again. Aware of that, that what I dream of next day or the day after, it happens. So there's the intention and the desire for something, and then there's a lag, seems to be a lag. It's a weird thing. So don't give up just because you ask. You'll get your prayers answered right away. Does anybody know how God feels in this world? Is that the question? We're all working on ourselves, working trying to, well, why don't we first say, well, God, how do you feel? So we know, at least know how God feels. Isn't that a good place to start? How we feel? Doesn't how God feel have something to do with how we feel? It should. After all, God created, is the creator of life, of reality, of experiencing, of all that is. So doesn't that have something to do with how we feel? It should, right? And yet here we are obsessed with our bodies. Our bodies feel tired, the bodies feel this, the body feels it. But is it really the body that is feeling that is the question. Now yesterday, I was super tired, so exhausted. And then I realized, you know, that I've always thought that, I said, what's causing this exhaustion? But the truth is, it is just a feeling that I'm having this moment. Nothing is causing it, except my desire to be exhausted, actually. I said, whoa, wow. I saw it, you know, I said, oh, wow. I said, you mean the moments aren't linked? So my exertion earlier isn't causing my exhaustion now, really. That exhaustion, any the way you feel is just your choice that instant to feel that way. The next instant, I realized my exhaustion could just vanish instantly. Instantly. But then we say, well, wait a minute. How did that work? How do we cause that? How do we get rid of the cause of exhaustion? There is no cause of exhaustion except our desire to feel. So there is no cause of sickness. It's only our desire to be sick is the only cause there is. And there is no real sickness because the next instant we can choose again. We can choose differently the next instant. Now, of course, we're not used to functioning this way, right? Well, that's why I say we have a continuity problem. But there are those who have functioned that way in this world, which I've paid attention to, as I've mentioned quite a few times. Sri Sri Anandamayi, for example, had this horrible cancer that metastasized throughout her whole body, just lumps everywhere. It's just like awful. It's one of the worst cases the doctor said he's ever seen of cancer. And he witnessed what happened, and for some reason, the play, she called it the play, with the cancer, had come to its conclusion, and the cancer left like that instantly. One moment she was, on death's door with cancer all over her body. Next instant, there was not a trace of cancer anywhere. This is absolutely true, and this is a fact that we don't have any state. You know, what state are you in? There's no such thing as being in a state. There's no such situation as being in a situation. There's no circumstance of being in a circumstance. There's no illness, okay, at all. And reality is inherent wellness. In other words, that's why I ask God, how does God feel? Because that's the inherency I'm asking. What is the inherent feel of reality? What is the inherent feel of reality? It's a very valid question. Because that's a default. You say, well, if there's no sickness, there's also no wellness. But when we realize our freedom, what is the feeling of freedom? Is it just nothing, or is it blissful? Or, you know, we're told it's blissful by those who've accepted it. It's just perfect bliss. So there isn't any situation, condition, circumstance at all. Because the very next instant, before you can even think instant, you can desire to feel differently, to experience differently, and that shall be what you're experiencing or feeling. But again, we're afraid of this rapid shift. It's called a continuity fear. See, continuity fear, the rapidity of the shift is too striking. So oftentimes when we choose to feel differently, it might take a little while. It might take a little while. We sort of gradually transition it step by step by step by step, choosing slightly differently each moment until we get to something that we want. Feel comfortable. And even the body, the appearance of the body, they're those who can simply appear and then disappear. Because they realize it's just a desire to appear as a body, and then change the desire to not appear as a body. So you might say all miracles are possible, inevitable. You know, all miracles are right now. We don't have to do a miracle. Reality is completely miraculous. So from our standpoint, if you want to use the word miracle, no time is needed at all. Ultimately, time isn't needed at all. But because of our continuity problem, we keep imagining as if there were time, even though there isn't. Time and space, as if something has to move through space or something has to take place in space instead of instantly, anywhere at all, everywhere at all. So how is God feeling? What's the God feeling? What's the God feeling like right now? What is God feeling right now? Shift gears a little bit, and when we hear this declaration, we're here to heal the separation. Okay, look out. That's totally dualistic, isn't it? We're here to heal the separation. What separation? See, by accepting that, you're accepting that there's been a separation. See, oh yeah, I want to be healed from the separation. I mean, you're accepting there's been a separation. There's never been any separation. There's nothing to heal at all, except a delusional belief that separation is possible. But that's not healed. It just, you know, you just let it go. But now maybe some that say that are just speaking to our thoughts and imagining, and they understand there's nothing to heal. You just let go of the notion that it's possible. Jesus is like that, but there are many who tell you that they're here to heal. Okay, but that makes, you can't make sickness real and then heal it. See, that is the huge mistake that we're making. So many are making. You can't make illusions real and then get rid of them. See, that's duality. That is the problem. That is what traps us. Traps us in what, in the world. Okay, we get trapped in the world. Trapped in the world. What world? There is no world. Believing that there's a world is getting trapped in a world. Now, I had a very interesting dream last night, and it pointed out a very important issue here. I call it the damsel in distress, attention trap that this world is. When you try to turn your attention away from belief in this, that there's such a thing as a world, a place, circumstances, consequences, conditions, sicknesses, separation, all this stuff. When you try to turn your attention away from that, what happens? Well, what happens is you hear some woman shrieking, damsel in distress, some pitiful, like someone is like, you know, being entrapped, has been kidnapped and being held somewhere and being mistreated. And you hear this pitiful whining and moaning and screaming, help, help, help. So I saw, and then you see these heroes come in with their guns and their first responders. They're smashing windows. We got to get in this house and find out. You know, some poor woman is being held against her will, and we must rescue her. You know, like that. And that's all your attention gets onto this drama. And it's very interesting if you look at society and the news cycles and all of this. How repeatedly, whenever there's some will in the world that gets built up to turn our attention to truth, suddenly all these stories suddenly start popping up a place about some damsel in distress, some woman was kidnapped when she was, you know, 6 years, 7 years, young, taken to some place and held there for many years against it. This all becomes like massive news, you know, all this kind of stuff. It's the pitiful damsel in distress that it snaps our attention back to the world. Oh, we got to help her out. But what I saw and recognized in the dream, I said, you know what? It was horrible. I mean, the cries of anguish were horrible. And we say, oh my gosh, there's something really hideous going on. There's some. I realize that this is an actress. This is a very skillful actress and an actor. And the whole thing is an act. The entire thing is an act. This whole damsel in distress thing is an act. It's how we get trapped. And then I remembered, how did I get trapped in this world? Along with all the inducements, what really did it was this pitiful, help, help, we're so trapped, help. The damsel in distress. And I just said, oh my gosh, I've got to be right to the rescue. I've got to be a white knight, right to the rescue. Come on, guys. Come on, guys, you know. Well, young woman is being mistreated. You've got to ride to the rescue. You know, that kind of thing. Entrapment. Tension got entrapped in this attention trap of the world. Now I realize it's an actress. She's acting. The whole thing's an act. The entire thing's an act. But wow, very compelling act. You know, the whimpering and the moaning. I'm so suffering. All this stuff. It's an act. Because we are spirit. We're not bodies. We're free. There's no situation, condition that can hold spirit at all. Impossible. So any idea of mistreatment and misfortune, all stuff, it's all an act. It's an intentional act carried out to entrap the attention of others. Okay, to entrap. It's how we try and keep ourselves believing in the possibility of being greater than God and separating from God. It is quite difficult to get the nerve to not ride to the rescue, not be a white knight. It is quite difficult. Because the rest of the world will say you're a hideous person. You know, how could you not? I say because it's all totally an act. An actor and an actress are acting this out. And it's all a scam. It's all designed to make us believe that we're not spirit, that we're bodies. That's what it's designed to do. Now, Jesus knows that's all an act, and this is what he tells us. And it's up to us to recognize it as well. So I would say the most clever hook of all is this damsel in distress sort of thing. And again, I've monitored this throughout my life. I look at for a long time I monitored the news stories, and I correlated them with my awareness of what's going on spiritually. And I found that preemptively, it seems like almost like preemptively, whenever there's a surge in willing, these stories suddenly pop up. It's amazing how I've noticed, but how it works. It's all choreographed. It is all choreographed at a deep level. In mind, mind doesn't have any levels, but we say very deeply, so we seem to be unaware of it. Mind is choreographing all of this. It's all an act. And all these stories pop up, pop up, pop up, pop up. It's amazing after this last election, where there's a changing in political parties, power and everything, suddenly after that, all these stories start popping up of damsel in distress. Women are in danger. Women are in danger. Women are in danger. You know, damsel in distress. Boy, are women bodies? Is the spirits identifying with women? Are they somehow not spirit? They're less spirit than the spirit that identifies with male bodies? Is that possible? No, it's not possible. Therefore, spirits identify as female bodies. They're still 100% perfectly free, all every single instant. They have lost no power whatsoever, no reality whatsoever. So for them, there is no situation, there's no condition whatsoever. Same as the spirit identifies with male bodies, zero difference. So it is all an act, 100% an act, with no exceptions, no exceptions and no exemptions. So they bring up the terrible, you know, rape stories. They just throw those out like candy. It's unbelievable how many, as soon as things start to realize, hey, maybe this is an act. Rape, they throw it out like this, and all the news stories around the world, some horrible thing, and everyone goes, oh my God, this is terrible. You know, and they focus on that. And again, I say the entire thing in this world is choreographed. It is all an act. It is all an act. And of course, saying this, your persona non grata in this world, for sure, as Jesus was, for sure, very persona non grata. And that's what hurt, you know, scary on the nerves, like, wow, it's very tough. But it's true, it is true. And we'll never escape this trap until we realize it's all an act. In other words, we are totally free. Every instant is perfectly free and clear for every other instant. So how can there be, we say that, oh, I'm been entrapped. Oh, I'm help, help, help. I'm suffering. I'm, you know, I'm being abused. Help, help. Look at this horrible abuse. No, they're actresses who are going through this, acting this out to make us believe that they're really bodies. See? And they can't help it. They can't help it. This is happening to them. The whole idea of anything happening to spirit is impossible. Nothing can happen to spirit at all that is not 100% its choice. 100% its choice. And spirit's perfectly free to choose every moment, and it knows this. So when it claims, oh, I can't choose again, I can't, I'm somehow bound. And no, they're trying to market the idea of separation to you is what they're really doing. Very diabolical, you might say, for sure. But very and very effective as far as deception goes. So, you know, who's willing to say this? Well, Jesus is, and I'm willing to say it because certainly I want to get free of this nonsense here. But it's a lot easier for Jesus to say it, in my opinion, because he doesn't seem to be here. If you actually believe you have a body here and you're in the world, you know, how can you associate or socialize with anybody if these are your beliefs? It's not possible. You know, there's not many people in the world who can accept this, you know, who can accept this. You just can't socialize with people and say, oh yeah, this is all an act, all those stories. Oh, how awful. What do you mean? I say, what do you mean, how awful? Well, those are actresses and actors acting out victimization stuff to convince us that we're bodies, that we're not spirit, that we're not free, and therefore that we have changed reality. It means then, therefore, we're greater than God. This is the deception. Who is going to listen to that? I mean, I tried when I was younger. People just shun me. I don't wanna go near that guy. What kind of life is that? You know, I'm tired of that, for sure. just hitting your head against the wall. I said, wow, boom, 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 boom. And no, nobody really picks up on it. But of course, they're afraid of being ostracized too, right? Absolutely. Those who, Jesus said, though, if you follow him, the world will hate you, absolutely hate you, which is true. The more than that, well, what's the greatest form of hate is it completely ignore you, shun you, ignore you, don't exist. that's not good. At least I admit that these actresses and actors who are acting out all this victimization, at least they're real, they're spirit, you know? At least I'm talking about them, but those who speak truth, the people in the world, they act like you don't even exist. Which means they're very frightened. Their continuity fears is very severe. They say, if I start listening to this, you know, what's going to happen? I might be able to manifest what I want each moment, be instantaneous, and oh my God, I can't function that way, you know. It just freaks them out. So that's why I say you have to have a monastic culture, which means people are dedicated to a lifetime of gradually moving their comfort zone, because it's likely to take a lifetime. The fear is so severe, it's likely to take a lifetime of listening, hearing, adjusting. Maybe even more than a lifetime, maybe several. But if you're really into it, you can do it in less than a lifetime. But what else are you going to do with your lifetime? If you don't do that, what are you doing? You're just continuing to buy into the lies. That's all. That doesn't help at all. So a monastic culture is a sane culture, just pragmatically. This isn't some ideal. I say this is the way we're supposed to always function. It's a pragmatic step, because you have to spend a lifetime at this, basically, more or less, because of the severity of the fear. Because if we were completely free every moment, wow, you know, we can just poof, I don't even have to be here, it disappears. People say, whoa, 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 wait a minute, this is slow down, slow down, slow down, you know, that's too much for us. Pragmatically, a monastic, more spiritual monastic type of culture is what I'm saying. That doesn't mean there isn't householders and farming and family life and all going on in the greater context. But the structuring of society and culture is aligned with monasticism. It is aligned with it. Not everybody is going to be a renunciate meditating, you know, 16 hours a day or something, all right? Right, but the overall structure is monastic structure, where you have to start considering that this is all delusional. This whole thing, idea of bodies is delusional. There can't be a body or a form that we identify as ourself, that has something to do with what we are, because what we are is perfect freedom, moment by moment. So we can never be bound by our imaginings, our experiencing. We're already complete. God created us complete, perfect and complete. So there's nothing we need to imagine, our appearance we need to imagine, in order to complete what we are, in order to make us right, so to speak. No, we're inherently right. We're inherently complete. And this is what Jesus means in dropping your valuing, which ultimately means dropping your belief in time. Because time is the belief that moments are bound together, which would then form a value, meaning a form, a process, a thing. Okay. And we do that because as soon as we do that, we believe we need that to complete ourselves, to be complete. I don't struggle with this, I'm just sort of introducing this here. This is the heart of the matter, but yeah, I can feel like, wow, yeah, that's very heavy. So you just hear it, you just hear it. Gradually, the more we hear it, the more comfortable we'll get with it. Valuing and time in this. We're just sort of getting closer and closer and closer to it. because if we see this clearly, poof, you know, that's it. We've done it. We're finished. So this brings up a sort of like, whoa, wow, real close here, real close. And then when you get that reaction, like, I think I might be too close. Okay, that's when you stop. Honor your creativity by realizing you really have done a great job in scaring ourselves. So yeah, wow, a little too close there. Getting real close, okay, all right. Steady, just steady it. Just stop right there and just steady yourself is all. This is the whole purpose of culture, monastic culture is based, founded on the realization we have a severe continuity problem and that we're honoring our creativity, and the fact is that we are very frightened and that we have to gradually get a little closer. Now, when you start out, it's like you make a little progress. You say, whoa, that's too close. You might be quite a distance away. But for you, you know, it will seem like you're too close. So I'm having the same reaction now as I had in the past. So that might be too close. But now I'm like really, really, really close. So I'm comfortable being super close. But the next step's like, whoa, maybe that's a little too much. So that's the way it goes. The path is very similar all the way along. I've found it's quite similar all the way along. Just moving your comfort zone closer and closer to dropping your valuing, which means dropping time. We don't need the belief in time. We don't need the belief in values at all to be what we are. We're complete. We are created complete. There's no way we need any completion. The belief we need completion is really the desire to change reality. And to say we're not what God created us, we're incomplete. That would be a change of reality. And if we're incomplete, then we're striving for wholeness, for completion. And that's where we dream up process, time, space, process, and form, as if moments were somehow bound together and that we need that to be complete. And if we don't have it, we think we won't have an identity. And again, this is for the purpose of getting familiar with this and getting used to it. Do those who have taken over this world, the big, really big business alliance, do they believe in God? No, they don't. They believe in the brain. They believe in the brain. They believe the brain is God, you know? In other words, they're valuing. They're valuing. They believe in valuing. And Jesus says, your biggest problem is ultimately time, belief in time, which plays out as valuing. And he says, you must drop your valuing of this world, valuing of time, space, process, form, valuing of thingness, valuing all that. Is that's the stumbling block that you have. So we have a world now that is fundamentally at the highest levels, the intellectual levels, fundamentally controlled by those who have extreme valuing. We're totally into valuing. So that's not a good outlook. It's not a good outlook. And they hold conferences and symposiums, and they're disseminating all this information all over the planet, you know, rapidly, rapidly, rapidly as possible. This becomes the new paradigm of the future. They're designing the future. It's all about valuing. And they don't allow any truth into their situation at all. If you talk about God, they say, well, you can't prove God. So we don't allow anything in where you can't provide empirical evidence for it. And so They basically deny themselves truth is what they're doing. So do you really want to live in a world where everyone is dedicated to denying themselves truth, believing they're a brain, that they're a body? What kind of situation is that? And of course, when you try to leave, there you hear the screams of the damsel in distress. And you say, oh my God, I better stay here. Something horrible. I need to right a wrong here or something. There are no wrongs taking place. There are no wrongs. There's only a silly, idle wish to be separate from God, which has no actuality to it whatsoever. But in our creativity, we've been playing this out. But there are no wrongs to right. There are no wrongs to right. There's only a continuity problem to evaporate. This is the whole basis of a monastic culture. Which has been used throughout history effectively. As soon as you start turning your attention to that, the screams of the damsels in distress, so many damsels in distress, hideous, you know. They're being ravished by evil monsters, and hideous things are happening. And if you don't respond, you're an accomplice to the atrocities, right? This is what they say. But again, there are no wrongs. It's impossible for a wrong to ever take place. Completely impossible. Which is why everything's actually totally perfect. They asked Sri Sri Anandamayi about World War II. He says, how can you just sit here? Why are you not working to bring peace in this hideous atrocities on the battlefield? And she says, what are you talking about? And they said, well, don't you bear the war? She goes, well, let me tell you what I see. I just see dear, loving friends playing a game with one another, acting out. One falls down. You know, and then they get up again, another one falls down, they get up again. And it's just a game they're playing, and they're loving the game, they're actually enjoying it. And this whole game of all this game of atrocities and death and dying and war and everything. She saw it the way it really is. She said, everything's perfect. There's nothing wrong going on at all. There are no wrongs taking place. There are no wrongs taking place. Because we're all completely free. Whatever is happening isn't happening to us. It's a result of our desire to experience this. Now we might say, well, but I don't really want to experience this. Well, this is what I would say is the continuity fear causes us to keep on choosing what we may say. Well, I don't really want that, but I think I better, because that's the alternative frightens me too much. But it's still 100% based on our desire, you see. There's, just because we say, well, I don't really want that. I mean, I would like to have something different, but I'm too afraid to. So then the desire says, okay, this is what I want to experience. And of course, our desire to separate from God. We can always choose to not desire to separate from God. That's not difficulty. Okay, maybe I need to take a little pause here for a moment, but bottom line, though, nothing happens to us. It's impossible for anything to happen to us that isn't our own desire that we be experiencing this. It's impossible. One moment. So, well, what's a good way to pray? Well, one of the ways is to pray that you, for a monastic culture, pray for a monastic culture. Super helpful. And again, this doesn't mean you're going to be locked in some cell for your life. A monastic culture, okay, a spiritual culture, monastic culture, where you gradually have the opportunity to more and more and more and more put your attention on truth. And work on this continuity problem, which can really take up your time and energy because it can be quite unnerving. But it's much easier to, and they agree with you. Whereas here, I say to Jesus, Jesus, I'll say the truth, but nobody's, you know, almost no one is going to listen to this here. No way. Yeah, I've proven, you know, proven it. I just proved it. This is right. This is true. This is what has happened. I said, I'll put these videos up here, but I guarantee you very few people will watch them. So the idea of some great revival here in the world, everybody's going to say, oh yeah, this is the truth. Nothing can happen to us, you know. All this stuff, victimization is just acting. Is that likely to happen? As soon as we start thinking that it's, that, oh, okay, yeah, here come the damsel in distress stories, saturated. Here come the dinosaurs, you know, the voracious dinosaurs with their mouths open, ready to eat you, you know, that kind of thing. Like, oh yeah, see, look how threatened you are. Look how threatened you are. Look how threatened you are. Look at all the threat. Look at all the vulnerability. Look at all of the unwanted stuff happening. Look how trapped you are. Look at all, see, get flooded with it. The world's just constantly flooded with this. Now, there's some embers or something. Possibly some embers here and there. But again, the numbers seem to be, you know, very, very slight. Even those who say they're channeling Jesus or whatever, you know, they always talk about the wrongs in the world, righting the wrongs, the need to heal the planet, the need to this and this and this and that. And I said, huh? Yeah, that's totally dualistic and misleading. Again, you cannot make an illusion real and then get rid of it. That's the false path. And so it's tough to see through this. And so what I'm saying is, no, I'm not condemning anyone. I'm saying pray for a monastic culture where you're able to actually get the job done, you know, and see through all this stuff. Otherwise, you're going to have a very tough time. I've lived like a monk my whole life, really, like monastic, just like in a cell, or, you know, just staying in the same place, like as if living in a monastery, basically, yeah. So I've been able to get this, work on this. But if you're hustling and bustling and out there in the world and socializing and everything, you're going to feel all the pressure to conform. Because if you start saying that there's no victimization, there's no wrong. Actually, the truth is, no wrong has ever taken place. Not one single wrong has ever taken place. No one has ever been wronged in any way. That's a fact. Now, if you start saying that, people are going to shun you. They say, this guy is completely nuts. I don't want to get near him. So then you have, just to socialize, you have to like live a double life, like, you know, as if you can't be true to your, you know, to truth here. Whereas in monastic culture, it's from the top down, this is all understood and accepted. And so the people then realize that, hey, we have the problem of a continuity problem. Truth doesn't have a problem. We're the ones who have the problem. See, in this world, it's flipped upside down. The ones who speak truth are seen to be the ones that have the problem. Oh, they're crazy. They have a severe problem. And the ones who are in a state of insanity and are believing in that wrongs are possible, in other words, an insane belief, they're the ones who seem to be sane. It's upside down. So a monastic culture is a repentant culture. A repentant culture. So Jesus calls everyone to repentance for sure. And all repentance means is to accept, yeah, I've got a severe continuity problem. Truth is true. I know truth is true. And I know that I've been trying to change truth and I can't. But I have a severe continuity problem because I've been believing in this stuff for so long. I'm afraid of this, the instantaneousness of reality, the inherent, you know, no exceptions, instantaneousness of it. It's just continuity shock. It's like we say, well, yeah, this world, well, let's wrap it up in a couple billion years, or maybe a little less, and then let's wrap it up in maybe a couple hundred millions of years. That's enough for this world. How about a couple million years? Maybe I don't know about that. How about a couple hundred thousand years? You see? And now, so try this. How about this world wrapped up in 10,000 years? Now your heart's starting to go, wait a minute, that's too soon. How about we wrap the world up in 100 years? How about we wrap it up in 10 years? Complete the world, poof, vanished. 10 years is finished, no more. Dropped it up, gone on to some other experiencing. How about 10 years? How about 1 year from now? How about 1 day from now? How about 1 second from now? You see how the continuity fear builds as you get closer to the immediacy of reality? This is the problem. So generally you have to say, you know, you take a lifetime to work this out. And people say, okay, I got a lifetime. So if you want to know what the continuity fear is like, just try that exercise, and this will show what it feels like. So we can say, yeah, a couple billion years, sure, I'm all for that. Let's wrap it up. And then start bringing it back closer and closer and see how your attitude changes. Until you're just like petrified, say, no, I'm not ready for that, I can't have that. That's the continuity fear right there. Because this whole world absolutely can vanish instantly. It's not a world at all, actually. All appearances, a self-released appearance is impossible. Appearance that isn't already inherently self-released is impossible, can never even arise at all. No such condition can ever take place. But, so our continuity fear expresses itself as time. Say, no, this has some duration, inherent duration to it. It has to last this long. This is a belief in time. Something has to last, separate from our desire, you see, through some other power, which we call time, which doesn't exist. There's no such power of time, none. But our continuity fear has it like, well, no, this world has to last at least another couple million years, meaning somehow this some intrinsic arising of appearancing of this world that is separate from our desire that it arise. And this is impossible. So time is impossible. Totally impossible. And yet, because of the continuity fear, pragmatically, we need to realize, yeah, it doesn't exist, but I have a continuity fear, so I need to gradually get used to this realization. Now, for a perfect example is I had a realization in 1978, and then I realized that's going to take me a long time to get used to this realization. So that's what I've been doing ever since then, actually. Ever since 1978, all I've done is get used to this realization that I already had. I already had realization, but I've had to gradually get used to the realization that I had. I'm still working on it. This is why monastic culture is so helpful. In a monastic culture, when in the right conditions, you will have realization, and then you're able to spend all your time gradually adjusting yourself to the continuity fear, gradually evaporating it, gradually coming to, you know, acceptance of it. which means dropping your belief in time, ultimately. So, I told Jesus, I will say what you want me to say. I'll try to say the truth in this world. So I came across A Course in Miracles in 1978 also, and I said, I will do my best to disseminate the truth here. Yeah, so that's what I've been trying to do. But it's, you can imagine how unpopular it is and how difficult it is to speak up like this. And how rare it is that because it's so difficult. Because we don't have a monastic culture, really. We have the opposite of that. We have a secular humanist culture. Capitalist, materialist, secular, humanist culture. So that makes it very difficult. If I was asked when I was young, what do you want to do with your life? I said, well, I want to be like Jesus, meaning disseminate the truth here. That's all. Disseminate the truth here. Urge people, urgent, you know, work as much as possible. Have your own little retreat where you live. Since we don't have overall monastic culture in the world, have a little retreat, a little space where you're able to focus in on this. Very important. A place where you feel comfortable in entertaining this truth, which is shocking. Partly because of the continuity fear, and also you realize that others will certainly think that you're some terrible, evil, wicked person. What do you mean there's never been any wrong? Are you absolutely crazy? You know, no, absolutely sane. There's never been one wrong. A wrong is impossible, which is why Jesus says sin and guilt do not exist in reality. There's only reality exists. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. There's never been any wrong ever take place. There's never been any sin. There's never been any guilt. It's totally impossible. All of that is our belief in time. All of it. And our belief in time is merely the belief that we are, that we can change reality. We can change reality, and we can't. Again, if we could change reality, it means we're greater than God. Our will is greater than God's will. So, in our attempt for our will to be greater than God's will, we've got into this terrible, you know, pickle of this continuity problem. But it's very resolvable. But when you have the entire world aligned against you, as we have now, it gets quite difficult. Say there's never been a single wrong ever take place anywhere whatsoever. Not that there's anywhere, but no wrong can take place ever. Impossible. There's no sin, there's no guilt, there's no accountability whatsoever. Nothing to account for, no accountability. Anything that seems to be a wrong taking place is a collaborative, cooperative, play-acting situation. It's acting. it's also understood that our creativity is so unlimited that we've certainly been able to put on a very good act. That's not so. This is why our continuity fear tends to be so severe. So this is pragmatically understood. So don't worry about trying to be defensive. Like, wait a minute. It's understood. If I say it's take a whole lifetime of gradually moving your comfort zone of tremendous effort. That's understandable, honoring our creativity, just how creative we are, to be able to make it seem, you know, so realistic. So we're not denying the realisticness of this. We're just saying it's all an act, very clever, compelling, creative, play acting, but it's not true. And people hear this, of course, and they say, well, all my friends would completely abandon me. Yeah, probably. That's why I don't have any friends. Literally. Other than on this channel, the viewers, you know. But they're free to come and go. But as far as actual, you know, friends that do stuff with and everything, I don't have any friends at all. Because how could I? You know, how can you speak the truth in this world and have friends, really? Very difficult. Because they want to engage you in play acting, like stuff is happening to you. Let's have some stuff happen to us. You know, let's reinforce this delusion. And they call that being friends. Those aren't friends, really. Partners in self-deception, you might call it, actually. So this is why Christians tend to say, oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. In other words, they put the friendship with Jesus first and foremost. Now, that's sort of a monastic culture. That's what it's about. So you're not worried about, is other people going to reject me or whatever. You're not worried about that. So it's okay. You don't want to. It's fine. But I have a friend in Jesus. I know that. That's very important. The sort of basis of Christianity is we have a fundamental friendship with Jesus. And so we can speak the truth about this attention trap we call a world. We can say no wrong has ever taken place. And we know that Jesus won't abandon us. You see, at least we have one friend. Now, I spoke with Jesus a while ago. I'm trying to remember what he said. He said something about you only need three. Something he was telling me, no, it's very simple, just three. Maybe he means that just two in the world who say, well, we're going to accept the truth and work on this continuity fear. And then Jesus is the third, that this somehow is sufficient to get, you know, to go forward and get the job done. Remember, I was talking with him about groups and how, you know, various things, and he said, no, it's very simple. Just three's enough. I said, what? Really? Just three? You don't need a big group, you know? No. Just three's enough. And he was one of them. He's one, so there's one there. So in this darkest times here. Maybe that's how people have to function somehow. He didn't say two, though. He said three. I remember him saying three that night. But again, he was gluing himself in that. I know the people in this world try to have triad relationships or something. I didn't hear him advocating anything like that, really. He was definitely one of them, part of a group. One, and then him, Jesus, and two others forms a sort of triad that is somehow able to withstand the pressures of the world. Maybe it's possible someone in this world is acting in this way. It can be Jesus, that person, and yourself. You see, that's like that. That's possible, too. Yeah, I remember him saying, no, this is very successful. It's very, very, very successful. I said, huh, interesting. So, as always, we give ourselves a little quiet time to let the shock of the, you know, what we spoke about, just let us settle in and realize we're okay. We're okay. This is great progress, actually. Tremendous progress. Now, we're afraid of Jesus. Why? Because he might ask us to teach the truth and say this. So I always said, stay away, Jesus. Don't get too close. You might ask me to say stuff, you know, too much. But now it's like, what could Jesus say that's too much? You know, there's no wrong has ever taken place. He'll say that. If you're already comfortable with this, what's the big shock? What was he going to ask us to say that is like totally shocking to us? Nothing. So why would we be afraid? Nothing has ever existed. Existence has never existed. Time has never existed. Time-space process form has never existed. No wrong has ever taken place. Victimization is completely impossible. There are no conditions or situations. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit as God created me. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Only truth is true. Nothing else is true. So what exactly, you know, for me, what exactly could Jesus say that's so shocking? He's already said it. That's the thing, he's already said it. And so we get used to it, that's it. He's already said it. So I can say to Jesus now, okay, Jesus, if you got something that's even more shocking, go ahead and say it, for sure. You gotta say it. So we can get used to it. But the idea is that teaching is given out first, for first phase, like the Bible, those kind of teachings, allegories, parables, like that. Get you started. It's shocking for the first phasers, it's shocking. And then later on, Jesus said, I'll give out more clear information. At least he implied that. this is spiritually implied. You can't understand this, but later on you will be able. I'll be able to speak to you directly. Okay. So he gave out a Course in Miracles, which was much more shocking. And then a Journey Beyond Words, which is really shocking. Really, really shocking. It took me 15 years with A Course in Miracles before I was ready for Journey Beyond Words. That's when he brought it out. Like, was like 18 to 20 years after A Course in Miracles was first made available. So it gave us, you know, almost 20 years to get to work, and then we were able to handle even more shocking talk. As, you know, wow. Then 20 years getting used to that. 20 years of getting used to that. So I would assume the next 20-year phase is going to take place. As I said, I believe that A Course in Miracles was at least being read by an inner circle of people about in 1974. And then Journey Beyond Words was made available in 1994, and now we're in 2014. That's another 20 years, and we're ending that. That's coming to an end. So I expect that something even, you know, that we're ready for, those who have gone on this path, will take place. Next phase will begin. I don't know what the next phase is, actually. But there's no need to worry about it. You just have to prepare. Get comfortable with the truth. Get comfortable with the truth. It's interesting because those involved with A Course in Miracles were not really aware of Journey Beyond Words, you know, what was taking place there. It just kind of suddenly was published. So it may be very well that those involved with the journey, A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, what Jesus is doing, may not be aware of what the next step really is. You know, it'll be here. Some way, and then people, those who are ready, will just, oh, what's this? See, in 1994, I was looking for the next step. Somehow intuitively, I said, there has to be some next step. Jesus is going to do something, has to be, because I'm ready for it. I had no idea what it was. I just intuitively, I said, there's got to be. So I was looking in bookstores. I was like, what's going to happen? And one day I walked into a bookstore, and there was this book. I said, what is this? And started reading it, and it's just, wow, this is it. This is it. So I feel the same way now. The next step is going to be here. Somehow it's going to be here. I'm not sure it's going to be a book either. I doubt it's going to be a book, because everything that needs to be said has really been said in terms of words. Sin is impossible. Guilt is impossible. Accountability is impossible. There's no such thing whatsoever. I mean, Jesus has said what needs to be said. There's nothing else, you know, to be said, really. Other than, I would say, if there's some sort of pragmatic step that may be taken, you know, that's a different story. As far as teaching goes, I believe the teaching, enough has been said. If you compare it to what Longchenpa said in Spaciousness, Radical Sanction of the Vajra Heart, it's the same. It's the same. It's the same. And that's the apex yoga. That's the highest teaching in the Buddhist tradition. That's the highest teaching. Jesus has brought same teaching, highest teaching. Beyond that, there's nothing that needs to be said in terms of words. So I don't expect some other book as far as teaching goes so much as the next step. I believe the next step is a side step. Okay, there's the next step. The next great step is a side step. Sidestepping the future of this planet in some way. So, I'm looking for a step, we might miss it. It's a sidestep. The ability to sidestep. Once we've already got the truth understood, we don't need to take another step to truth, but we can take a sidestep to avoid losing that truth or being, you know, pulled back down into delusion. The future of this world, as I see it, is profoundly dark and dualistic. Under the guise of being totally tolerant and open to all any and all ideas, like the TED conference, you know, technology, entertainment, design. This is the big, you know, world idea think, global think tank now that is pumping out all these ideas throughout the world. And if we're totally tolerant, we're totally open to all ideas, we want all the great ideas and speakers in the world to come forth. Oh, except, you know, you can't really talk about consciousness beyond the brain. God, you can't talk about there's no sin, there's no, oh yeah, well, there's no proof of that stuff, you can't have that. So they're totally tolerant of all the ideas that they're tolerant of, but they're completely intolerant of the ideas that they're intolerant of. How does that add up to tolerance? I'm not quite sure what the algorithm is that they're using there. Interesting algorithm, they might want to work on that a little bit. Might take a while. There's too much continuity fear there. So they won't quite look at that, no. But so you have these global think tanks, this New World Order think tanks operating, you know, throughout society, pushing the agenda through all the politics, the corporations, the innovations, the big companies, you know, it's all shaping the future, designing the future is what they're doing. So, designing a future of total tolerance except for those things they're not tolerant of. Could anything be more dualistic than that? Could anything be more delusional than that? That's the heart of delusion. They're very, 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 what do they call it? Calling out, or whether there's some kind of thing that they say. They're very careful in who they select to talk, and they also select the audience to listen to the talk. Wow. That's an open society, isn't it? Have these philanthropists at the top deciding, we know what's best for the world, we know what's best for your future, so we're going to design your future for you. So we make sure that the speakers and the audience all agree with what our future is going to be. And then we declare, look how open and tolerant we are. What a great society we have. It's hilarious. What's funny is that they think that everybody actually agrees with this and wants to go along with it. That's hilarious. It's like Nisargadatta Maharaj and a couple of kids down the block putting on a little play, little street play. He says, what the heck? Why the heck do I need to know anything about that little street player? It's exactly like that. He likened this world to some couple kids down the block putting on a little street play, you know. A couple of poles and a rope or something, banging some drums, and you know, he's like, why are you asking me about that? You know, that has no importance whatsoever. World's intoxicated with designing the future, you know, with time, intoxicated with time, the intoxication of time. make believing that we're greater than God. But they don't realize that they're bringing about this continuity fear within them. And so when they get tired of it, that's when they get bitten. It's like, what the heck is this? You know, I thought I could just drop it. Whoops. You know, I want to drop it, but I'm too afraid to. And then that's when the... they say, uh-oh. What can you say? They're so headstrong and, you know, so enthusiastic and adventure about this great adventure of time, that when they tire of time, then they realize there's never been any time. Time doesn't even exist. They say, whoa, 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 whoa. That's too much for me. I can't take that. It's like saying we're perfectly tolerant of everybody except those who talk about truth. That's great. Very funny stuff. It's like, again, like a couple of kids now putting out a little street play and they're making these bullet pronouncements, and you can't help but chuckle. You know, listen to kids imagining stuff, you know, and saying this, I'm doing this, and it's funny. It's like that. It's a little chuckle. You don't hate the kids, you know, it's just funny. So silly. For sure, that those who've been liberated, those who recognize the truth, they don't have the slightest belief in time whatsoever. They know for sure there's never been, or could ever be time. Totally impossible. And they have no resistance to that truth whatsoever. None. And people will be that way eventually too. Yeah, but it takes us. We don't let go of time so easily. We're like, a little bit. Gotta have a little bit of time, you know. Give me a little bit of time. Give me just one more day, Lord. That's a song. Give me one more day, Lord. Give me one more day. There are so many who have gone astray. I need one more day. I need one more day. Meaning, I need time. I need time. And we use the excuse, well, there's so many who have gone astray. I can't let go of time. Nobody's gone astray. Nobody's, nothing, no wrong has ever happened. No separation's ever happened. No one's gone astray. There's nobody trapped by time. There are no damsels in distress whatsoever. But that's the nastiest hook of all, I would say, because in this world, when you see a damsel in distress, you know, you automatically go, oh, let me help. You need some help here. Okay, gotta do that. It's the right thing to do, you know. This is the scariest thing ever. When you're seeing a damsel in distress, you say, uh-oh, this is a trap. This is a trap for sure. But if you don't help out, you know, you feel like you're some intrinsically evil person if you don't help, you know. If you don't allow yourself to be trapped, essentially. Meaning, trapped into the belief in time. So, send the Holy Spirit to help out somehow, yeah. It's a tricky one, isn't it? Very tricky. Makes it very nervous, you know, very nervous. One of the reasons of nervousness, because there's so many gambits and scams going on constantly in this world that you can't help but be pulled into, it seems like, unless there's a monastic culture, which is why monastic culture is so important. Monastic culture oftentimes, like for instance, you're not allowed to, like for men are not allowed to help out women like that, because it's they know it's a damsel in distress situation designed to pull you into the belief in time. Why? To reinforce their belief in time. Because they feel if they don't have time, they won't exist. Why use the term exist, speaking to thoughts and imaginings? I mean, if they don't have time, they will not be. Isness will not be. this is the belief. So they think they have to have time. So they feel they're losing the belief in time. They think they're going to have no being. They will be annihilated. You know, they're looking for some way, how can I reinforce my belief in time? And they feel like those who are getting free of time are very threatening to them, very threatening. So they try to act in certain ways to try and diminish that threat. It can become very, very entangling.
Absolutely.
Terrible. That's why I say monastic culture is way more helpful. Certain limits have to be set. That, for instance, these people are off limits to family. You know, relationships, best relationships, all this kind of stuff. They're completely, inherently vowed, taking vows to be off limits to that and cannot get engaged in that. So there's some parameters. There has to be some parameters there. Otherwise, in this world, everybody's fair game. You know, everyone thinks that they can just target anybody to help increase their belief in time. And they certainly do. Because that's what the world culture is about now, is you know, increasing the belief in time. By saying, look at all the great things we can do with time. You know, look at all the ways we can function so wonderfully in with our belief in time. Not realizing it's bringing about drastic continuity fear, which they'll regret later on, for sure. But they don't understand the leverage that the Holy Spirit uses. So no matter how bad the continuity fear is, it's a piece of cake for the Holy Spirit. It's a piece of cake, easy, no problem. But it could certainly seem like a problem to us. So, again, we get back, what's the next step? Maybe a side step. A step to the sidelines. Sidelines of what? The sidelines of this future that this world is working on. So, you think that they're just going to keep going on and you're going to be left behind. But no, at some point they realize, whoa, they'll turn around and come back to you and say, wow, I don't like time anymore. You know, can you help me? Just imagine, you all these braggadocio people and the spirits in this world who are so boasting about how time is their friend and they're how great it is, you know, how great form and all those beliefs are. And so, of course, they're acting like, you know, the world is their oyster, this is wonderful. But just realize that they will be singing a very different tune later on as they tire of time. And they'll be desperate for those who have realized that time has never existed, never been. It's never been. Existence has never existed. They'll be desperate for it. So you're not being left behind. It's like, let's say you have a really nice base camp and some people leave the camp and they go wandering up and, you know, I want to climb that hill. I want to climb that mountain. And they go up there and you think, oh, they're leaving us here and they're getting some wonderful experience, you know. But later on, they come straggling back, and they just tell the horrors of trying to climb that mountain. You know, it's just like hideous. We had a terrible time, so many disasters. It was just awful. I'm never going up that mountain again. Forget it. And can you help us? We're so sure. Come on in, refresh yourself. They say, oh, thank you. They stagger back into camp. So all these folks here that are, you know, pretending to be world beaters, and they're gonna design the future, you know. They'll come staggering back into camp, haggard. Their eyes will be like, we've seen some terrible stuff, you know, awful, you know, can you help us? And we say, of course, relax, everything's fine, everything's perfect. They say, why, what are you talking about? Well, here, just have a nice little place here, a nice little hut here, and gradually calm down, and start being quiet and still, but of course, the idea of just being still isn't the end all and be all, actually. The effort to be still, it's a helpful technique, absolutely. But without releasing the belief in time, you know, you have to work at that. You have to release your valuing. You can't just keep all your valuing and say, I just want to value stillness, do, and we'll keep it all. You know, it doesn't work that way. Anyway, these stragglers will come back from the future. They'll say, wow, the future wasn't very cool at all. And so we'll be, you know, welcome. We were expecting you. Amapur, we were expecting you. So look at it that way. The world is not leaving us behind. We're not being left behind as you sidestep the future. We're not being left behind. Because all adventures in time are misadventures. It's never what we really want. It is never what we really want. So eventually the stragglers will come back. Maybe we are the stragglers, right? But we got tired of our adventures in time. So we're the ones straggling back to camp and have been listening, you know. And so there are others will come straggling back in. Maybe it'll take them a while. These ones here seem very all revved up, got their engines all revved up. They say, we got a whole universe of time to explore here. Yeah. And the stragglers will keep coming in, so. The lost sheep keep coming back. Lost in time and space. The dream of time and space. So again, we just talk, just for the purpose of getting used to it, getting familiar with it. There's nothing succeeds better than that, just getting familiar with it. You cannot have time and true tranquility. Both. Can't have both. Cannot have both. When where one is, the other isn't. For one says there's absolutely nothing I need to do to complete what I am. The other says I'm incomplete. And I need to figure out a way to complete it. But it's never enough. Of course it's never enough, because there are no things actually being, there's nothing taking place at all. So you're just working with nothing. And saying, I can never make nothing sufficient. That's right. The idea of time doesn't exist. So working with that notion is working with nothing. And so we always feel like, wow, if I stop, I won't have anything. You know, well, I'll be incomplete, forever incomplete. That's not true. We're forever complete inherently, and that's never changed. Again, all this is said with a understanding of the continuity fear, and we struggle with this, of course. Just getting used to it. We're not asking anyone to just, you know, realize it. You know, we're certainly inviting as much as possible in that direction, but we understand this is really shakes us up. Shakes us up. Maybe tomorrow, we say, maybe tomorrow we'll be enlightened. Yeah, maybe tomorrow. But it's never hardly ever gets to the day, does it? But that's why we need to keep working at it. Next step is a sidestep. And again, there's nothing you need to know about the future, except that it doesn't exist. Time doesn't exist. So those stragglers that come back say, help, help, help. You know, what do you need to know about the future? Like, whatever, you just need to help align them with the truth, gradually, that's all. You don't need to know the adventures they've been on, misadventures. All time is just one misadventure. All the stuff they think happened to them, nothing happened to them. So this doesn't matter what someone thinks what happened to them, whatever form it happened to them. To the Holy Spirit, it's all the same. It's all the same. No distinctions are drawn whatsoever, because none of it's true. Why draw distinctions between what is completely is untrue? There's no need to. So we think that somehow we have to go along in the future to figure out, well, what are all these misadventures that you're having so we can heal the misadventures. It's not necessary. It's not necessary. To the Holy Spirit, they're all the same, one and the same. And teaching is very simple. And you don't have them focus on the content of their misadventures. That's not important. No need to draw distinctions among illusions. Differentiate between illusions. They're all equally untrue. All units of time are equally untrue. You see? All units of form are equally untrue. All units of wrongs are equally untrue. We don't need to draw distinctions among illusions like that. So we don't really need to follow the storyline of the future to be able to help out. Of course, they'll say, you don't know what really happened to me. You don't understand this. All this stuff happened. And we say, nothing happened to you. I say, what do you mean, nothing? Nothing can happen to anyone. And they say, wow, what? Yeah. So we think that if we sidestep the future here, we won't be able to help. This is not true. This is totally not true at all. We'll be better able to help, actually. This is very important to realize. We'll be way better, more talented and more helpful if we don't even worry about that at all, because we'll understand exactly how to help them towards realization. And we ourselves will not, you know, be caught up in making differentiations between illusions. Very important. Because they tell you, oh, if you don't go along with this, you'll be totally ineffectual. That's a lie. It's not true. If you go along with it, you'll be ineffectual. That is true. They twist it up and got it backwards. But you won't know what happened to us. Something awful happened to us. No, nothing happened to you. Nothing can happen to you. You just tried to reinforce time. And therefore you had to keep acting out these roles that you didn't like. It's just, wow. So, just have to drop the belief in time is the answer. But they'll say, what roles can we play that can make time seem wonderful? There aren't any such roles that make time seem wonderful. It's inherently fearful. Belief in time is inherently fearful. Inherently, you believe in your own death. You believe in that you can die. If you believe in time. So I would say the next step is just the conviction to sidestep the future and realize that this is going to greatly help your effectiveness. Greatly help it. You're no longer worried about what form illusion takes. You see through there, it's all the same. Nothing. Who cares what form nothing takes? So I think that's maybe the next sidestep to sidestep, is to be able to accept this. It's not easy. I've struggled with this for a long time. Because you feel like you won't be able to relate to anyone, but that is not true. You'll be able to relate on a level of truth with everyone, easily. Okay, so I'm interested now in what happens, because I'm on board with this. I think more than not, there's still some ambivalence, but I'd say more than not, I'm on board with sidestepping. So let's see how events open up. Let's see how the flow goes now. Very great. Should be quite compelling. All right, that's it for this video.